You're tuned to Radio Maria, a Christian voice in your home. We now present our program, Sacred Treasures, with Kathie Duggan.
Praise be Jesus and Mary, and welcome Radio Maria family. As we begin our program today, please join us to pray for the intentions of the Queen of Peace. Sacred Heart of Jesus, have mercy on us. Queen of Peace, pray for us. St. John Paul II left us a rich legacy of his voluminous writings. On Pentecost Day in the Basilica of St. Mary Major, he said, O Mother of men and peoples, you know all their sufferings and their hopes. He entrusted the Church to Mary, Mother of God. Radio Maria follows in his footsteps, entrusting our stations around the world to Mary. It is with the help of our staff, volunteers, and you, our listeners, that we're able to repeat these words of wisdom on the air. Thank you for this opportunity through your generous prayers and donations. May God bless you with peace. During this month of May, we focus on the words of our earthly mothers who often look to Mary, the Mother of God, for guidance. Our next guest has received a call within a call to embrace our Blessed Mother in a very special way. Anne Ferrand was a member of a contemplative Carmelite monastery for 33 years and is listening to the Holy Spirit, who is guiding her with a new mission. Anne, thank you for joining us today.
Oh, I'm so honored to be here. This is my very first ever radio interview, Kathie.
Oh, wonderful. And we just want to hear about your journey. We would like for you to begin and tell us about some of your early faith background.
Well, I was blessed to grow up in the Wichita Diocese, which is famous for being the number two or vying with New Orleans for the most number of adoration chapels. There's a great deal of fervor there, a lot of Catholic heritage, like Louisiana. I'm new to Louisiana, and I'm just amazed at how similar the Catholic spirit is down here. It's just homegrown faith that's got deep roots. And so I was the oldest of seven children, and we were all pretty much one after the other. I was the oldest of six by the time I was nine, and number seven was born after I was in the convent. He was a Johnny-come-lately. So I went all Catholic schools, and I was surrounded by, I had school sisters, and I knew from my childhood that I would have to choose, what God would want for me, and trying to be open, whether that was to be a mother, which was a wonderful vocation, and I was surrounded by babies, so I was very open to that, or else to be a sister. But I was only exposed to, like, teaching sisters and nursing sisters and on TV, I think I knew about missionary sisters. But for some reason, even though we had statues of St. Therese of Lisieux, I was not very well understanding of the cloistered vocation until eighth grade, when an old Polish priest was asked to babysit our religion class because the normal teacher had to go somewhere, and he didn't know what to do with us. So he started telling the story about St. Therese of Lisieux, who wanted to be a missionary, but also felt called to just pray and sacrifice for the mission. And she understood that no matter how great the example that you set for somebody or how great the preaching is, if they're attached to sin in some way, someone has to pray for that person and make sacrifices to help them detach from that sin so they can really respond to the grace of the call to become a Christian or to become a better Christian. So when he started talking about that, my heart was on fire. I could hardly sit still in my desk. I was about 13, I was in eighth grade, and I just could hardly wait for him to stop talking so I could run to the library and get that book on St. Therese. And sure enough, when I read her, I knew that this was something, this was the most exciting thing I could think I could ever do with my life. But during high school, I was backpedaling a bit because I thought, her prayers would be worth something. She's a saint, but you know, I'm in the cloister, so, and who am I with my humble prayers? Maybe my life wouldn't be worth too much. And so I had to really get deeper into my faith and understand that God doesn't call us because we're worthy. He calls us because we have a job to do, and He'll supply the grace for that. So I wanted to enter right after high school, but the wise sister said, no, you need to get some college. So I got a year and a half of a Catholic college, and then just at 19, just before my 20th birthday, I entered Carmel, and my family drove me there, and they were so proud. And my parents were proud of my vocation. They never resisted it in any way. And so I was delivered to the Carmelite nuns. We didn't get to do a come and see. You just entered trusting that this is where God wants you, so that the cloister door opens and then it snaps shut and you're inside. And it was happily ever after. I never had the least regret. I was excited every day of my vocation. We slept on a sack of straw, a canvas bag of straw on a wooden pallet, and then the alarm clock was a sister going down the corridor, banging two pieces of wood, saying, "Come to prayer, sister, come to prayer." And I would just get up every morning excited that this is what God wanted me to do. And I didn't know who my prayers were benefiting, but that didn't matter. I knew whether it was somebody next door or somebody across the world, somebody was benefiting, and God would choose who that was. And I just loved the life. I loved thinking that my life, everything I did, washing dishes or typing or praying we were always praying because there was so much silence. But no matter what my occupation, it was being offered for the Lord and whatever the superior asked me to do. And so I was there 33 years and figured I would live to 100, because unfortunately nuns are the last to go to heaven because it's such a healthy lifestyle. We die very old. So I was in my early 50s. I've been there 33 years, and it was Holy Week. And we had extra time allowed for prayer. If we could get our chores done, we could spend part of our normal work time in prayer. So I got some of my chores done on a Holy Tuesday and Holy Week, and I was up in the little choir looking down on, that looks down on the Blessed Sacrament, and I was up there praying. And I can't really remember what I was praying, but I'm sure it was something on the Passion. It was Holy Week. And it was like someone just like took my head in their hands and just moved my thoughts in a sudden another direction, changing everything. I wasn't thinking about this at all, but it started coming to me very strongly that the church would be moving into serious persecution, all Christians of all denominations. Well, you know, that wasn't real surprising. I mean, Mary's been talking about that forever, but I wasn't thinking about that. It was suddenly that was the focus of my thoughts. And then I understood that I was supposed to leave the cloister and encourage people in the faith during this trial, and that was surprising. But then I heard six clear words. It said, and, besides leaving the cloister, promote the rule of Mary. And I was so surprised. I think I said out loud, "What is the rule of Mary?" And I turned around, like, "Where did this come from?" And I heard one more word, "Lost the let." And I like to tell people that, you know, normally that would have been shocking, a horrible thing. You have solemn vows, and that would scandalize everyone to leave the cloister. But I didn't feel like that at all. It was like your husband comes home from work and puts his arm around you and said, "Honey, I've been transferred to another city and we're going to have to move, but we'll be together and we'll make friends." And I thought, if anybody's being persecuted, I want to be there. But at the other hand, I knew, because, you know, I was steeped in St. John of the Cross and Teresa of Avila and all the Carmelite saints that warn you very much that Satan is very clever, and we must never trust private revelations without doing a lot of research and getting some facts before we get adhered to anything like that, because I knew it didn't come from my imagination, but I couldn't be sure that Satan wasn't tricking me, because he would be very happy to get me out of the cloister and embarrass everybody, right? So no, I wouldn't let that happen. So I decided to to pray and study, and I would not do anything until I got my hands on that rule and read it. Because what I did know about La Salette was that the first part of the public message, this was back in 1846, this was the very first public revelation of Mary that you could actually go up to the seers and talk to them. Now, the very first public revelation was 1830 to Catherine Labouré, when Mary wanted a she called it the Medal of the Immaculate Conception. And the bishop, the confessor, brought that news to the bishop, and the bishop had faith. He believed in this. He thought this could be something that grace for the people. So he had a number of them struck and distributed, and there were so many amazing miracles that it got to be called the Miraculous Medal. And this was little the postulant Catherine Labouré, and only her confessor and the bishop knew which sister it was in her large community of the Daughters of Charity. So people got to know that some sister had this revelation and that there were special graces with this medal, but nobody knew, not her superiors, not her other sisters, and she would live another 50 years in anonymity, just being a regular sister, and while these graces were just going like wildfire around Europe. And then the next one was to a Carmelite, but she was also in the cloister, and we won't go into that because we only got a short time. And then the third one was La Salette, where she appeared to two mountain children who were kind of like you would call them hillbillies. They were not very educated at all. They were pretty backward socially, and they didn't know, they were never formally educated in their catechism. And here the Mother of God appears to them way up high in the Alps. And the people immediately believed because they knew that these two children were very trustworthy, and there were some signs that the people had no doubt, and neither did the parish priest, who began preaching it the very next morning. It was a Saturday afternoon, September 19th, and the parish priest started preaching about it Sunday morning. The bishop finally calmed him down and said, well, we've got to investigate this. But it was something that very much captured all of Catholic Europe, and people were making pilgrimages on foot up the mountain. This was a huge, you know, effort, but Mary was calling. The public message at that time was that our Lord was very displeased with the people not keeping the Sabbath holy. They were harvesting and working, making money on Sunday and shopping and doing whatever they wanted, and not really going to Mass very faithfully. And then the other thing was blaspheming, using the Lord's name in vain. She said this is would call down great punishments on France and the world. And so the people, there was huge conversions. There was so much enthusiasm. People were so thrilled that the Virgin Mary would come to them. It was such a novelty. Now we're kind of used to it. But for 2,000 years, there were private revelations, but not with a public message. And so this was very exciting. But that day, both children said they'd also received a secret that they would reveal later on, but they couldn't reveal it right away. So everybody knew that they received some secrets, and so these secrets were written down and sent to the Pope and the bishop. And so from the very beginning, these secrets were not completely secret. I mean, they were known to be there. But within 5 years, the bishop, after he consulted Blessed Pius IX, he formally approved the apparition of La Salette, and the Pope had seen the secrets. So it was approved, but the secrets were still not well known. So it went on making waves and being very excitable in the church for about 12 years, and then it was time for Melanie to release her secret. And that secret, it was like something out of the pages of the Apocalypse. It's very dramatic language. The kings would be at war and hail of wild beasts and all sorts of things. But it starts out with great complaints of the sins of the clergy and religious and Catholic politicians who were supposed to be leading their countries in holiness. And so it's very, very very unwelcome message to the people who were in high places. And from then on, little Melanie is maligned and persecuted and told she made it up and not even allowed to come back to France. She had to live in Italy for some time. I'm sorry about this phone. I should have turned off this phone. Okay. So I knew that part of also, I knew the public part of the message that was clear, but this long, very apocalyptic message is very crypto, you could say. I mean, I was familiar with it, but I didn't know what it all meant, the symbols. And I didn't realize that, and I went in the library, I found that in the middle of that message, or toward the end, Mary said, "Now I'm giving you, Melanie, a rule for a new religious order for the last times, plural, times is plural." And the book we had in the library did not give that rule, and it wasn't in the appendix. The only thing it said that Melanie got to see, like envision, members of this order working, doing different apostolic work. It was like they were all spread out on this mountain, the men and women of the order, wearing the distinctive habit, which is a long black tunic with a white sash, kind of like a bishop's sash, and white shoes. So I'm thinking, you know, maybe that rule is just as apocalyptic as the rest of it. Maybe I would never. Maybe it's not a real rule. Maybe it's just something Satan wants to trick me with. So it took me. Where would I get the rule? I mean, surely it was in French somewhere. And so that was a trick. How do you get that in the cloister without, you know, making that known to anybody that you're looking for it? Because we didn't have internet. But I was the only one that did have a computer because I did some layout work for the monks who live nearby. And so I had permission to ask the turn sister from time to time to put a little flash drive on the turn with a note and for her to ask our benefactors, well, I would like you to look up something from the internet and please bring me back that file. So very surreptitiously, I said, well, you know, we would like to compare the rule of St. Albert, which is what the Carmelites are attached to, with the rule of St. Augustine and the rule of Mary. We would like to, you know, study these things as if, you know, the monks were interested. And could you bring these back in digital form so we can search them more easily? Well, they brought back the digital file of the rule of Albert and the digital file of the rule of Augustine, but no rule of Mary. So I waited a month, you know, and I tried again with some other benefactor. This went on for 12 months. I had every rule and many versions of them by the end of the year, but no rule of Mary. And so I thought, oh my. So now I was back in Lent, and in the meantime, I had meditated a lot on La Salette and been praying, you know, for light on this whole thing. But I was at the end, and I didn't know who else to ask, and I wasn't going to bring this to the priors or tell anybody about it unless I saw that rule, because I didn't think it was prudent to even mention it, because to even let anybody know that I was thinking about leaving the cloister. You don't want that kind of rumor going around inside the cloister. It's a very closed environment. And it can destabilize people. I think Sister Anne's having doubts about her vocation or something. That's not true. So I said, you know, I'm getting close to the feast of St. Joseph here. And it was Teresa of Avila who really got St. Joseph known. She had a huge devotion to him. And in Carmel, St. Joseph, the feast of St. Joseph is almost like Christmas. And so I said, you know, St. Joseph, this would be the order of the Blessed Virgin Mary, the order of the Mother of God. So you would be the protector and the provider. So it's your business. I said, so St. Joseph, I'm going to make the novena to your feast on March 19th. And please make it known to me that if this is something that's deceiving me, then I will just let it go and forget it like I never heard it. But if it is something I'm supposed to do, please get me that rule. And so the eve of the feast was the Laetare Sunday, and the monks, it was a gorgeous mass that morning, Sunday morning. It was Laetare Sunday, and they chanted everything in Gregorian. Oh, it was so beautiful, and it was all such a joyful mass. And I was coming out all happy, and I was taking off my choir mantle and about to fold it up, put on my choir box, but there in my choir box was the rule of Mary printed out in three languages, a flash drive with the rule of Mary in six languages, and a post-it note that said, oh, sister, we found this some months ago, but we forgot to bring it to you. I said, okay, St. Joseph, I got it. So I ran upstairs and read the rule, and it was nothing apocalyptic about it. It was a very beautiful rule, and one of the tenets is that we will give retreats and preach very strongly the four last things, heaven, hell, judgment, and purgatory, so that people will remember their death and not forget these truths of the faith. And, of course, there's a strong emphasis on Marian devotion. And then, of course, making Mary's messages known. And there's one thing that's very interesting that really touches my heart, that the order is supposed to have little special, it's not a major apostolate, but in time, the order is supposed to have, like, houses for sick religious, those who have lost their fervor, spiritually sick, and that need to be reinvigorated so we can send them back, so that people in this order can send them back to be a good Dominican or an excited Benedictine, so that they have an appreciation for their particular calling. And so this order will be kind of, Mary called it the mother of all religious orders, because there will be a maternal concern for all the orders, that they all flourish because they're all from the Holy Spirit. There's no competition among religious vocations. Are you still there, Kathy?
Yes, I am.
Said a word.
I need to introduce you once again to our guests. You've been listening to Anne Fran, who belonged to a Carmelite monastery for 33 years when she received a call within a call, which she is talking about now. And this was with the permission of her superiors that she's going in a different direction. This is Kathie Duggan of Sacred Treasures, and we're so interested in knowing what are some of the current changes that are directions that you're taking to try to set up for this order. Someone doesn't just begin an order. Tell us about some of these steps.
Well, that's quite true, and most people probably don't realize that there are actually thousands of congregations down the centuries and in the church, and many of them are just at the diocesan level, so you don't know about them too much because they're serving where the Holy Spirit has led, and they come and go. Sometimes they just have a charism for a time, but the majority of new congregations through the centuries have been started by a religious who was a member of another congregation. It's kind of like King David was trained in the court of Saul, so that he would know how to be a king. And so God gives us a background in these things. So there's a whole protocol for this. Mother Teresa of Calcutta, she was a Loreto teaching sister when she experienced her call within a call to leave and become a missionary sister. And so once the order and the superiors discern that this is probably a legitimate call, then they have to submit that to the various places to get you dispensed from your vows, because you don't just take poverty, chastity, obedience in the air. You take them to a superior under a particular rule or constitution. So it's all managed by the church. It's not like marriage vows, which is really, the church just witnesses marriage vows. That's a sacrament. But religious vows are actually managed by the church, who can make them and unmake them. And so my priors very much believed in me, and actually so do my sisters. And so she contacted the bishop and gave him a very warm, let him know that this is a serious sister who wouldn't have made something like this up. And so the bishop was very, very accommodating, and he did all the paperwork to get me to Rome. And it took a little while, but first there was exclaustration, and also my superior was she just died of cancer. This has been it's sad, but she was very much on board with this, and she said, "Well, you just can't just go off and start an active congregation. You only have you're only a cloistered nun, and the voice I heard was only promote this rule." So she thought we both thought maybe I was just supposed to join an active congregation and offer this rule as a way to stimulate their own constitutions. But in any case, I needed to be formed and trained as an active sister. And so, long story short, I got a wonderful 2-year formation with the SALT Society, the Society of Our Lady of the Trinity. And actually, I didn't get to leave Carmel right away. Of course, there was a lot of protocol to get out. And also, I had to train people because I was a vestier. I was a seamstress. I had to help train someone to replace me. And, of course, I was on the computer, so I was doing a lot of different things. So not everybody could replace me for what I was doing. So there was it took several years to get out, so to speak. And then I was in the SALT. And then I was hoping that they would, I would just be one of their sisters and they would take over whatever this order is supposed to look like. But they said, no, we've discerned that you are capable and we aren't called to be exactly this thing. So you've got to do it. So I just said, where do you go home but to mom? After all these years, you go back to your mom. And so she believed in me, and she had a spare bedroom. So I got a spiritual director there in my home diocese of Wichita, Kansas. Father Bernard Georges is founder of Totus Tuus and a very Marian priest, and he was very excited to help me. And he introduced me to lay people, and he said, sister, the first thing you got to do is just get a YouTube channel and a website and just talk about Mary, because you've been meditating on Mary's apparition for most of your life, and you have insights I've never seen. You can connect all these messages and all these apparitions. And so he emptied his pockets and rented me an apartment for 9 months, and so got me kind of known. And I sat there, watched tutorials, built my own YouTube site and website, and and then people wanted to come and hear me. So lay people, prayer groups, just quietly wanted to listen. The bishop wasn't that interested in another order right now. He had some other religious he was hoping to sponsor that were young and starting. So he just kind of let it grow and quietly didn't let Father Georges handle it. And so then I got invited to France, and people thought, well, maybe it's supposed to start in France. I thought, oh, no, I don't know a word of French. So anyway, it was quite an odyssey. So I ended up in France for a while, and it was such a gift because I ended up with some very valuable documents in digital format. So so it makes that's the first step of getting them translated, getting them in digital format. And I got to go to La Salette, the mountain itself. So it was a huge grace. But then I found myself back in the United States, and my mother thought I would stay in France, so she downsized, and I had no place to stay. So Father Bernie Georges, he said, nope, you cannot get a job and support yourself and get an apartment. You just have to trust in Providence. You need to work full-time on getting this order known and manning your website and keep loading up more and more talks. And so he said, we're just going to trust in Providence. And pretty soon, someone offered me a bedroom, free bedroom, and I have been living in other people's houses ever since.
Wow, what a story, what a journey. And tell our listeners, before we're out of time, where they can read about what you're doing.
Well, the YouTube channel is one word, Marian News. And my most popular, I have 130 videos up there, but the most popular series is on the apocalypse, what Mary has said about our times, because she has told visionaries that we are living in the time of Revelation. So that's Marian News. And then my website, where I try to duplicate and offer other things. The website is getting bigger and bigger, but it's a work in progress. It is House of Mary, M as in Mary, D as in David. OMD stands for, it's Latin for Ordis Matris Dei, which would be the order of the Mother of God. But right now, my main work is trying to get the rest of the documents translated into French so that it will be the basis for a constitution. And when we get that done, then we can approach a bishop, because we can't start anything officially till we have a bishop.
Right. Let me ask you something. Have you, by any chance, had any more inspirations to the tune of what took place through when you first had your interlocution, or you heard the words from heaven?
No. No, that was it. But it was so strong. I have never doubted that for a second, and I couldn't. And, you know, I'm not a visionary. That was not an apparition of Mary. Locutions and visions are not part of my normal life. But what I did experience all through my religious life was amazing insight into Scripture and into the Marian apparitions.
Right.
And I was just thunderstruck during my prayer time, because we had 2 one-hour periods of mental prayer every day for meditation, and that went on for over 30 years. So that was a lot of prayer time.
Wow.
And plus, we had a lot of study time, a lot of reading time. And so my mind kept being filled with more and more things. I kept seeing connections, because, of course, we were praying the liturgy of the hours all the time, and there were so many pieces of Scripture being thrown out at you all day long. And I said, hey, that fits with that, and that fits with that.
Wow.
So I would say I'm gifted with many insights.
Right.
It's almost like I don't want to say it, but almost there is a charism of being a prophet, a prophetic charism, but there's another for the interpretation of prophecy. Mm. And sometimes I feel like, have I been gifted with that? Because I just see so many connections with the prophecies.
You know what?
So that might be it.
Pentecost is coming, and so we can certainly pray to the Holy Spirit to help us, and we're out of time. And thank you so much for sharing with us, and I would like to invite you to come back and keep us posted as this goes on. We're very interested in sharing your work with others.
Well, thank you very much, Kathie. I was honored to have my first radio interview with you and Radio Maria. God bless you.
God Bye-bye. Bless you, too. Our guest today has been Anne Friend, who received a call within a call to begin a new religious order. Hope you've enjoyed listening.